Good evening, good morning, good middle of the night for some of you in Hawaii. It's great to have you with us. My name is Vijay Prashad, Director of Tricontinental Institute for Social Research and a member of the group that puts together No Cold War. Just want to take a brief second to remember a very important person who was assassinated today in 1993. And that was Chris Haney. Today is the day we lost one of the tallest trees on the African continent. Chris Haney was a leader of the South African Communist Party. Chris Haney was a great anti-apartheid fighter. And at the edge when South Africa was going to emerge as an anti-apartheid state, the terrible forces of history decided to cut him down. To kill Chris Haney and thereby weaken the working class movement in South Africa. Let's dip our flags today for our great comrade Chris Haney. Welcome to For a Peaceful Pacific, opposing NATO's military aggression. This is an event that we at No Cold War are very pleased to present. Please go quickly to our website at nocoldwar.org. You will find our founding statement from 2020, which warns against the hostility imposed by the United States government on the people of China. We call for mutual dialogue and hope that the world's people will come together to address the common dilemmas of humanity. Is it not more important to abolish poverty, to abolish hunger, than to build up military force? So we believe. The statement at our website, nocoldwar.org, is signed by countless people. You can sign it too. So go to nocoldwar.org and read the statement, sign it, and share it. Why is this event called a Peaceful Pacific and NATO? After all, NATO, the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, is meant to be restricted to Europe. But in recent years, the United States has driven a so-called pivot to Asia, fueled largely by the realization that Chinese science and technology has equaled, if not gone ahead, of Western science and technology. The United States imposed a conflict with China over 5G technology. That's the core example of this particular pivot. NATO went into action in Afghanistan in 2001, and since then, there has been talk of the expansion of NATO into Asia, or the creation of a NATO-like organization in Asia. The development of the Quad with Australia, India, Japan, and the United States, this talk with the Quad and with other formations, so-called groups of democracies, now seems to be near reality. Is the Quad the new Asian NATO? These are some of the themes our two panels will address. I will chair the first panel, and then my colleague Jenny Clegg will take over to chair the second panel. Panel one is titled Rising Militarism. We have five superb speakers who will each speak for 8 minutes. I will introduce them before they speak. We're going to start the first panel with Anne Wright. Anne Wright is a member of the CODEPINK National Staff. After college, she spent 13 years in the US Army and 16 additional years in the Army Reserves, retiring as a colonel. She served as Deputy Ambassador for the United States in Sierra Leone, Micronesia, Afghanistan, and Mongolia. She was one of only three people who resigned from the US government in opposition to the United States war on Iraq. Since 2003, she has been a tireless advocate for peace. Anne Wright, welcome to No Cold War.
Thank you, Vijay. It's a pleasure to be with you. I'm speaking to you from the occupied sovereign nation of Hawaii. it is here in the islands of Hawaii that the Indo-Pacific Command, the U.S. military command that covers half of the world's area, is located. And when we talk about NATO coming into the Pacific, it's through the Indo-Pacific Command that that is happening. And in fact, there are four partners in the Pacific that are not official countries that make up NATO, but they are what are called the partners. And that's Australia, New Zealand, Japan, and South Korea. And they cooperate with NATO. In fact, the United States as a lead country in NATO from the beginning of the creation of NATO, and all of the military bases that the U.S. has all over the Pacific, it's a launching pad for any official NATO country that wants to come into this area. And in fact, these countries do come in. If we think about RIMPAC, the Rim of the Pacific naval exercises that are held every 2 years in the waters off Hawaii, many NATO countries send their warships to participate in that massive 25,000, 20 ship, 200 aircraft, submarines, you name it, and it comes out here into the Pacific to practice war. The war, they call them games, but they're not games. They're war practice maneuvers. Those maneuvers are actually going on right now in the Western Pacific, which should give us all great pause, because the possibility of accident, or perhaps intentional collision of any of the ships of the big armadas that are actually sailing in the South China Sea and up through the straits around Taiwan and then up toward Japan, where we have large U.S. Navy armadas, not just one aircraft carrier, but there may be two carrier groups that are in that area with the Chinese coming in with their armadas. So it's a very challenging environment that's out in the Western Pacific that we in the U.S. Really read very little about. Here in Hawaii, we do have a local newspaper that keeps us a little more up to date, I think, than most newspapers do. And it's been very interesting. About every other day, there's an article that comes out about what's going on, a little article about what's going on in the Pacific, but more articles about the weaponry. And as a retired Army officer, I'm very interested in all of this equipment and all of the new strategies that are coming up for the U.S. military forces. And it's quite substantial. The U.S. Marine Corps is totally revamping how it's doing things. It's giving up all of its land tanks, the giant tanks that were part of Gulf War I that raced across, tragically, across the Middle East and Iraq. They're giving those tanks up, and instead they have a new strategy. It's called island hopping. Small groups of Marines will go in new ships. I mean, part of this is who can get the most money out of the Congress for new weaponry. And so the Marines have decided to chuck their tanks, and instead they're going to go get new types of landing craft that will allow them to go on to small islands where they will wait for an enemy ship to come, and then they will attack the enemy ships from the small groups that are on the small islands. A little bit of a different strategy, almost maybe going back to like World War II in the Pacific. We also have new equipment coming in for the Air Force. For the very first time, Reaper Assassin drones are going to be assigned out in the Pacific. We're going to have six on Oahu. We're going to have six in Guam and six on Okinawa. For the very first time that this type of killer unmanned aerial vehicle will be assigned out here in the Pacific. The Army that you think about ground forces, well, the Army has decided it wants to have a new weapon system. So it's getting into the Air Force's territory. And with a cooperative agreement with Australia, they have cooked up one of the hypersonic missiles. And in fact, that missile, the hypersonic missile, is going to be tested in the war maneuvers that'll be taking place in Australia in May and June. That's called the Talisman Sabre, which may have up to 34,000 people in person that in Australia are going to be doing war maneuvers, plus the testing of this hypersonic missile for the air, for the army. And then everybody wants involved in this. So the Coast Guard, now the Coast Guard is taking up many more military missions in the Western Pacific. We have three new Coast Guard cutters here assigned in Honolulu, and there are new Coast Guard cutters that are out in Guam, and these are taking on military type missions. So it's quite a field out here in the Pacific. There's a lot of actions that are going on that are unknown, and they all kind of relate back to NATO. The NATO countries are using this, the lily pads, so to speak, that are out here in the hundreds of U.S. military bases that we have out in the Pacific, so that they too can be a part of launching any sort of actions against, you know, the enemy. And really, for the first times, the U.S. is actually calling China as an enemy. The head of the Indo-Pacific Command has said exactly that, which is a very, very disturbing use of the language. I mean, it's calling China an enemy, which we certainly do not feel. I mean, there's challenges on both sides, the West and China, on a variety of issues, but as another part of my career as a diplomat, we ought to be resolving these issues without killing each other and without war potentially on the horizon. So that's kind of an overview of what's happening out here in the Western Pacific. And we want to thank you all for being with us today and learning about what's happening. And there'll be a lot more people that'll have a lot more to say. So I want to thank you very, very much for being with us. Aloha.
That was Colonel Ann Wright. Colonel Ann Wright is on the national staff of CODEPINK, one of the bravest organizations for peace in the United States. It's great to have you with us, Ann. Really super. We're going to move to another extremely brave person, my comrade Ajamu Baraka. Ajamu is a political scientist, active against war and warfare his entire life, but not just war and warfare, what lies underneath it, which is imperialism and white supremacy. There are few people on this planet Earth who are as much the carriers on, the inheritors of the mantle of W.E.B. Du Bois, you know, his principle of black internationalism in particular, Ajamu. So important to have that, loud and clear, articulated loud and clear. He's a national organizer and spokesperson for Black Alliance for Peace. And in 2016 was the Green Party nominee for vice president. How different the United States would have been if Ajamu Baraka had been the vice president starting in 2017. Ajamu, welcome to No Cold War.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Vijay, for that very generous introduction. Really appreciate that. You put me in some very heady categories. Hopefully I can live up to a portion of that in my very brief comment. And Vijay, please do me a favor. I'm going to be looking at my notes going back and forth. So when I get to like a minute, just verbally let me know. Okay. Appreciate it. So I really, again, thank everyone who's responsible for organizing this event to allow me to share a few comments this morning, and for some people this evening or even night. This is a very important topic, of course, because what we are all concerned with is the possibility of an escalation of conflict leading, in fact, to direct war. So it is important for us to be critical, to be quite honest, to have no illusions about what it is we are up against. You know, we saw with the Biden administration, the illusions being perpetrated by some that this administration might be reflective of a change in US policies, that there will be a commitment to de-escalating tensions and a commitment to the US becoming a peaceful nation or a nation committed to peace. Well, many of us felt that this was a fantasy. It was based on a misreading of the US, of US history, and a misunderstanding of the hegemonic interests driving US policies. So what we have seen with the ascendancy to power of the Biden administration is a administration still committed to advancing US interests using military means. You know, we see the arrogance and the white supremacist psychopathology of decision makers in the US and Europe reflected in the comments of the new Secretary of State, Anthony Blinken, last month in Alaska, where he declared, without evidence, of course, because it doesn't exist, that China, that China's actions, quote, pose a threat to a rule-based order designed to maintain global stability, unquote. Now, of course, this contradicts the views and opinions of global humanity that consistently in global opinion polls identifies the US as the number one threat to global peace. You know, so while global command structures and basing systems of over 800 foreign bases, the understanding that the $753 billion proposal for defense spending in the US, the development and testing of hypersonic strike capabilities, the pivot to Asia where 60% of naval and other US forces are being situated, and the intensifying Cold War with China and Russia, this posed to become a direct and even hot war from Ukraine to the South China Sea. It is clear that when the US talks about diplomacy, when it talks about forward basing for quote unquote deterrence, that these are in fact obscuring the real objectives of US policies, that these bases are offensive capabilities meant to reinforce the US and European colonial capitalist project. So it is our responsibility to be very clear about what we see and what is in fact in play here. And one element that I want to bring into this understanding of this examination of the new Cold War and the instability resulting from US aggression in the Indo-Pacific or Asia-Pacific area is another very important issue, and that is Afghanistan. It's important for us to talk about that because that's part of the US aggressive posturing vis-a-vis China. Here we have a situation in Afghanistan where the US basically objectively has lost the conflict in that space. But they are still attempting to try to undermine the so-called peace process that was initiated by the Trump administration last year that called for the US to basically withdraw its forces, all of its forces, including its mercenary forces from Afghanistan. With the Biden administration, they are now attempting to undermine that agreement that has the US withdrawing forces by May 1st, with very little opposition from even unfortunately the anti-war movement in the US and Western Europe. This is a critical issue because we understand that the real objective of the US attempting to stay in Afghanistan has nothing to do with its concerns about human rights. We know that's a fraud, but it is based on their attempts to try to undermine, try to block Chinese interests, try to ensure that if the US is forced to continue to limit its physical presence, that they will be in a position working with their allies to try to undermine the ability of the Chinese to expand their influence in that part of the world. And they're concerned about that because of the Belt and Road Initiative. They're concerned about the moves have been made by the Chinese to connect up with Pakistan. They understand that in Afghanistan, you have something like $1 trillion worth of precious unexploited minerals like coal and iron and gas and cobalt, mercury, lithium, and they want a part of that. They want to block the expansion of the China-Pakistan economic corridor. They want to remain in Afghanistan because they see the possibility of mischief, if you will, in undermining China and in whipping up oppositional activities in the western part of the Chinese landmass, primarily working with and working through the situation with the Uyghurs. So these are the objectives of the U.S. attempting to stay in Afghanistan. It is our responsibility, folks, my friends, to basically raise these issues and make all of these various connections we are making this morning. We have to show our friends that it's important to understand and to describe the situation, but even more important for us to build opposition to it. We have to demand from ourselves and our friends and allies to be more vocal on the attempts by the U.S. to mask their interests in Asia. We've got to directly confront this notion that the U.S. is some champion of democracy and human rights. We can't concede that ideological territory to the U.S. Confront them on this issue of democracy and human rights. We have to expose the U.S. as being the warmongers and aggressors that they in fact are. So my friends, we have this task, this responsibility. And that's why those of us in the Black Alliance of Peace, we have taken on this responsibility to bring attention to Afghanistan, connecting Afghanistan with the acceleration of tensions and the escalation of aggression in the Indo-Pacific, Asia-Pacific area. We say we need to bring back and redevelop the campaign to close all US and NATO bases. We've got to undermine the idea that NATO stands for something that's progressive. NATO, we say, is a white supremacist structure and needs to be exposed in that way and opposed. Finally, it's important again, that we build a more effective global anti-war movement and connecting that to an understanding of the material basis of the aggression by the US and Europe. And that is to connect this to the absolute necessity to build a global anti-imperialist movement. It is our responsibility, our task, my friends, to in fact do that. This program this morning, this evening, this tonight is a program that is very, very important. We need to disseminate the conversations and use this as a basis for our organizing work to move from description to organizing. That is what the historical moment demands of us. And it's something that I think that all of us are capable of. And it's time for us to begin to move toward that strategic objective on the part of global humanity. Thank you.
Ajamu, Baraka, Black Alliance for Peace, thanks a lot. The point you made about Afghanistan is a crucial point. In many ways, the drive over Xinjiang is related to the operation, the long-standing operation in Afghanistan. I just want to point out before I bring in Julie Tang that recently the US 7th Fleet, which I remember intimately from 1971 when they came to threaten to bomb my city of Calcutta during the war over the liberation of Bangladesh, the U.S. 7th Fleet recently entered Indian territorial waters around Lakshadweep. And when they were challenged, they said that they were merely challenging India's excessive maritime claims. I want to say this because India is a member of the Quad. India is a subordinate ally of the United States government, and even subordinate allies are treated with contempt. Let me repeat that. Even subordinate allies of the United States government are treated with contempt. We're going to turn now to Julie Tang, a retired judge for the San Francisco Superior Court, co-founder of the very crucial platform Pivot to Peace, a US-based group dedicated to advocating for, well, something that should be obvious to everybody, world peace. In particular, peace between the United States and China. In 2017, Julie Tang helped found a very important group, Comfort Women Justice Coalition, that built a Comfort Women Memorial in San Francisco in the United States. Previously, she had co-founded the Rape of Nanjing Redress Coalition in 1998. And if those of you don't know what the Rape of Nanjing refers to, I highly recommend reading about the very long war, the very long Second World War that took place in Asia. It didn't begin in when Hitler marched the troops into Austria. It began in 1937, 2 years before that, at the Marco Polo incident, and lasted in many ways till 1949. Didn't really end in 1945. So please go and read up on the Rape of Nanjing. Very important. Julie Tang, welcome to No Cold War.
Thank you, Vijay. It is such an honor to be on this panel with you, Carlos Martinez, and such a stellar group of peace advocates. First of all, thank you all so much for your continuing efforts to inform the public why the world community should say no to the US-China Cold War. Today, I'd like to talk about the victimization of Americans in this Cold War. The escalation of the US military in the South China Sea has created its first real human victims. You see, when the US points a gun at China, it is Asian Americans who get shot at. Asian Americans are the first casualties of this Cold War. Asian American women, elderly, are being killed, our children being bullied in schools, and adults assaulted physically and by hate words. Asian Americans no longer enjoy the fundamental human rights to safety and security in our own country, the calm that every citizen should enjoy going about their own business in their own country is no longer available to Asian Americans. I've lived in the United States since 1967. This is the most trying time for me, my family, and all Asian Americans, especially those who live in big cities. Most of the Asians I know are carrying some kind of weapons with them when they go out. I carry a pepper spray and my keychain has a sharp pointy end, and I sometimes wear a whistle. It may be an overkill, and I never imagined myself doing something like that. But we saw videos of Asians being battered, being assaulted. And just a day ago, I saw a video of two women, Asian women, sitting in an outdoor cafe in New York's Chinatown. A non-Asian person walked up to them and just slapped one of them in her face and walked off. It was horrific, and it broke my heart to see anyone slapped like that. We need to defend ourselves. The hate incidents against Asian Americans in 2020 represents a 150% increase over the year before. Close to 4,000 hate incidents have been self-reported to the Stop AAPI Hate website since March 2020. Now, racism and discrimination against Asians and other minorities is embedded in our US history. The United States has never been able to tackle this serious social problem, and it just let it fester. The hate and rage from the American populace are most intense when the US is at war with a particular minority group's country of origin. For many years, American Muslims lived in fear and faced hate, violence, and massacre in the US and other Western countries when the United States and her allies were fighting in Muslim countries such as Iraq, Afghanistan, Syria, Yemen, and Libya. It is now a pattern that each time when the US is planning a war with a particular country or region, it will then plan some propaganda stories targeting U.S. citizens that make us hate that country and its people. I recall Americans hated Iraq's Saddam Hussein because we were told that Iraqi soldiers were killing Kuwait babies in incubators, raping women, and Iraq had a large arsenal of weapon of mass destruction, which would be used to do dangerous harm to the U.S. I recall Saddam Hussein told the U.S. he didn't have any of these weapons, but Secretary of State Colin Powell took a tube of powder and told the UN Security Council that U.S. had the proof. They turned out to be lies, but these lies prepared us sufficiently for war with Iraq and resulted in an estimate of over up to a million Muslims and 5,000 American servicemen killed. Iraq is a destroyed nation after we had our shock and awe war game with them. Right now, the Biden administration is going by the Trump's playbook in accusing China of genocide against the Uyghurs. The U.S. Office of the Legal Advisors, which advises Congress and different U.S. departments, including the Secretary of State Office on international and domestic issues, has refused to find China committed genocide against the Uyghurs. They found insufficient facts to sustain such a label under the 1948 UN Convention on the Prevention and Punishment of the Crime of Genocide. But the US Congress and the White House went ahead and sanctioned China for genocide and even got EU and Australia to do the same. To me, it is like a jury that came back after hearing all the evidence and acquitted an accused of a crime. But the government went ahead and punished the accused and handed down a sentence to him. Does this all make sense? For Asian Americans, it certainly makes no sense because we are now the recipient of a public scorn that is not even based on any proven, rational, or established fact. Some people said Asians should not link the hate crimes to the US-China Cold War. This would give China a break and it doesn't deserve and excuse it from all the bad things that it is doing, in particular, human rights violations. They name Hong Kong, a country where I was born, Taiwan and Xinjiang as the basis for China's human rights violation and reason why we should maintain the Cold War against China. Hong Kong and Taiwan are China's domestic and sovereignty issues, and we have no right to say anything about that. And the so-called genocide in Xinjiang has already been determined by the US's, by United States' own attorney that it could not be established under the rule of law. The evidence is so speculative and conjectural. But the Western media plays it up and prints only negative articles about China to substantiate a non-existent fact of genocide. BBC even doctored and cut and pasted a video that China produced in order to fake an image of forced slave labor. And these lies, exaggerations are the reasons Asian Americans will continue to suffer under a hate that is sanctioned and promoted by US foreign policy. The rhetoric used by our government leaders are so inflammatory, so cleverly crafted, it leads to one thing, hatred of China and its people, but the bullets fall on Asians in America. In the face of increasing violence against Asians, I believe Asian Americans have one choice to make, demand peace from our own country and say no to any kind of war, because life for us will never get any better if the relations between US and China does not improve. And US military operations are being rammed up, Asian Americans are falling. But we may still have a window, small window, to fight for peace, and it is now. There's no other option except peace for all humanity. On behalf of Pivot to Peace, I wanted to express my deep appreciation again to Carlos and Notre War and Vijay for all your hard work for putting this program together and allowing us to participate in this program. Thank you so much.
That was Julie Tang of Pivot to Peace, a crucial component of the peace movement in the United States. Very important comments, Julie, about how militarism, ramped up rhetoric against a country, has dramatic impact on people of who claim or who seek their origin from that particular part of the world. We've seen this over and over again. You're quite right to draw the full line between the attacks on Asian Americans now and the attacks on people who looked like Muslims from 9/11 onwards. One of the striking things about racism is it's both cliched and boring, and it's deeply ignorant in even precise things like, who are you beating up? After 9/11, the early people who were killed were Sikhs. What's the point even of saying, we're not Muslims, why are you killing us? Because the bigot, the imperialist, doesn't really care. They just think they know what they're doing. Vincent Chin, a Chinese American, was killed because the people who killed him thought he was Japanese in Detroit during the ramped up tension between the United States and Japan at that time. This is the platform of No Cold War. I ask you to go to our website, nocoldwar.org. Please read our statement, sign our statement, share our statement, campaign with as much energy as you can muster to dial down the tensions raised by the United States government against not only China, but against, well, almost every country in the world. There needs to be a transformation in the character of the US government. It has to better represent the needs of the US people. The people who are getting attacked because they are seen to be from a certain part of the world. Please go to nocoldwar.org. Please join our international campaign. Very pleased now to welcome KJ No, a peace activist, an analyst, a writer, a teacher specializing in the geopolitics of the Asia-Pacific region. KJ is part of Veterans for Peace and is particularly active in a very important part of the peace movement, which is to create, to develop a lasting peace on the Korean Peninsula. KJ No, welcome to No Cold War.
Thank you, Vijay. I'm really honored and happy to be here with you. This is a very, very important presentation that that we're doing today. So without further ado, I would actually like to share my screen. And I'll just jump right into the content. So the key point, and I don't really have to belabor this, but the US is escalating to war. And currently there is an epidemic of attacks against Asians. These attacks are inseparable from the racist attacks on China. That is to say, wholesale policy hate mongering trickles down into retail violence, and Asians are collateral damage. If you prepare to attack Asians over there, you will get attacks on Asians over here. Sinophobia kills. Now, people will say, isn't Trump the cause? But these attacks are happening outside Trump's sphere of influence. They happened before Trump, and they continue to spike after Trump has been silenced. This is a little graphic from the New York Times. You can see after Trump had his social media taken away from him, there was an even greater spike in attacks. Biden and Eli Ratner said Trump was too weak on China. Blinken said China is committing genocide. The policy precedes Trump. So where does this come from? Of course, we know the history. When the first contacts with China happened, there was a great shock to Western white supremacy. And therefore, there was a quick pivot that the Chinese were immoral. They were despots. They were completely a threat to the West. So Horace Greeley said, Chinese are uncivilized, unclean, filthy on beyond all conception. And he was a progressive. So we see that in history, the mass lynchings, the greatest lynchings in American history were actually of the Chinese. And of course, entire American fortunes, the great fortunes, were built on the exploitation and the violation of the Chinese through narco trafficking. So in a country developed on settler colonialism, this anti-Asian hatred is one of the most enduring prejudices in the West. And so we see that Trump has tapped into these old stereotypes, these race war stereotypes. Chinese are dirty, dishonest, depraved, despotic, and dangerous. They're responsible for COVID. So again, we have to understand this in the larger context of this escalation to war. Of course, we all know about the Naira testimony, but we have to understand essentially that when we are being told absurdities, they are to prepare you for atrocities. The US is actually already engaged in hybrid warfare, multi-domain hybrid warfare, economic warfare, tech warfare, legal warfare, diplomatic warfare, military brinksmanship, civil subversion, and academic warfare. And we're seeing total information warfare. Once again, those who tell you absurdities are preparing you for atrocities. So we can understand also the geopolitics of this. As the Soviet Union fell, there was no longer any political need to engage with China, but there was also the understanding that China could become a challenger to the United States. This is Andrew Marshall. He was considered Yoda. He was the top advisor to 12 secretaries of defense. And he essentially mentored an entire generation of people that we now recognize as neocons. This is one of these neocons. In 1992, Wolfowitz wrote up something called the Defense Planning Guidance Document, which was a plan for global US hegemony. This was so embarrassing, they had to disavow it when it was leaked, but it became the project for a new American century. And then this became the Bush Doctrine, which became the Obama Doctrine. And then as part of the Obama Doctrine, we had the pivot to Asia, which was essentially a plan to encircle and contain China. Along with the pivot to Asia, less known is that there was an actual plan for war. This is Andrew Krepinevich, who kind of worked out the nuts and bolts of war with China. At the same time, there was two groups, blue team, red team. They had sharp axes to grind on China from the Cold War. And once again, you see the blue team members, Michael Ledeen, Robert Kagan, John Bolton, a rogues gallery of extreme hawks. These people essentially stated that there was no hope of coexistence with China. They also subscribe to this understanding that China, if it were to build relations with other countries, that it would become the pacing threat to the United States. This is a topological map. China has more connections to any other country in the world. It's also, all of this can be connected through overland routes. The US has to fracture this connection along the quote unquote, the world island, that is the Eurasian continent. If it fails to do that, then the United States will lose its power and the world island Eurasia will become the pivot state and it will essentially shift the global gravity of power. So this is why we have the encirclement of China. This is air-sea battle. This is the plan to encircle China and shut down its trade routes. China's response is to build the Belt and Road, and you can see the overland routes that go through Myanmar and through Pakistan and then all the way through Europe. The US in response is escalating. It has something that it calls the third offset, which is its plan to attack China through swarming, automated warfare, subsurface warfare, guided missiles, building a wall of missiles around China using cyber warfare. And of course, this also ties into the fact that China is a threat to the US-led system of capitalism. The China's socialism with Chinese characteristics works and it outclasses the West. The US has originally expected China to collapse like the Soviet Union or to assimilate as a junior partner in this global US-led neoliberal system. Of course, that didn't happen, especially in 2008, when it became clear that the US-led neoliberal system had collapsed around its own ears. That's when the daggers came out. So the US ruling classes are desperate to erase China and its example. It offers a threatening alternative model of development that is non-capitalist, non-Western, and non-colonial. And also it undermines the West's neo-colonial domination of the third world and its debt-trapped base forced under development, subservience, and expropriation. So the ruling classes will go to, in the West, will go to war to prevent this. This is what we're facing right now. The greatest threat to the US is not China, but the US itself, 13% poverty, et cetera. And also by politicizing the virus, we fail to understand the seriousness of the threat, and we failed to copy China's effective non-pharmaceutical measures. So we are in a moment of total deceit. Our work is cut out for us. We have to prevent the war, but more than that, we have to prevent the first casualty, which is truth. I want to invite everybody to organize, act. Despair is not an option. Thank you.
Despair is not an option. KJ, no. Thank you for that very informative presentation. KJ's work is available at the Chow Collective's website, at Black Agenda Report, other places. People are asking, how do we get our hands on that PowerPoint presentation? Well, wait and see. Or go to the Chow Collective website where you'll see it. Chow Collective also published a terrific piece recently on China's vaccine internationalism. I highly recommend going and taking a read of that. It's an important text. But down to our last speaker of the first panel, we're going to turn things over to Derek Ford, a spokesperson and organizer with the Answer Coalition, works as an assistant professor of education at DePauw University. He's chair of the education department at Hampton Institute. Derek Ford, welcome to No Cold War.
Thanks so much, and thanks to all the presenters. You know, when we talk about the, you know, No Cold War, I think we have to understand the real continuity between the old Cold War against the Soviet Union and the new Cold War against the People's Republic of China, which is clearest really when looking at Korea, because the first hot war in the Cold War was the US war against Korea, which really began in August of 1950, which is 3 months after forces from the North liberated almost the entirety of the peninsula from occupying forces. And it ended in an armistice on July 27th, 1953. And that was 2 months after the Joint Chiefs of Staff unanimously agreed to use atomic weapons, not only against the North, but also against the People's Republic of China. And since then, you know, the US has refused to sign a peace treaty or to normalize relations with North Korea. And the consistent consensus within the US political establishment has been, you know, really nothing but the overthrow of the government in the North. And along with, you know, China, the DPRK remained and has remained after the overthrow and dissolution of the USSR and the socialist bloc countries, despite really the most comprehensive and complex set of sanctions. You know, I mean, they can't even import pens or pencils because of the lead or the graphite in them. And, you know, of course, the military pressure. So the US war continues now for over 70 years. And it's a war against what KJ was mentioning, an alternative social and economic system, one that prioritizes people over profits, and also, you know, an indigenous government, a government that's actually controlled by the Korean people themselves, totally. And so, you know, because when Korea was divided in 1945, the US and the USSR agreed to leave the peninsula by 1948. Since 1953, there's been no foreign power, no foreign military or anything in North Korea, but the US has never left. And in fact, maintains, you know, a network of bases, around 30,000 troops occupying the country. So in terms of China, I mean, I think it's a mistake to see the DPRK as only a pretext for US military presence and intervention in Northeast Asia. Although the propaganda that the DPRK, you know, represents some kind of threat to the region or to the world remains incredibly powerful in legitimating the US military occupation of South Korea against the will of the Korean people, the occupation of Japan, and the general military presence in the Pacific. And it really couldn't be further from the truth because, you know, the DPRK has never invaded or bombed or occupied another country in its entire existence. And I led one of the last US delegations there before the US imposed a travel ban. And, you know, the reason they don't want US people going to North Korea is because the propaganda that we've been subjected to for decades, you know, so it really easily and quickly falls apart. You know, the DPRK's military budget is about $4 billion. And it sounds like a lot, but it's really the equivalent of the New York Police Department's budget. And actually, if you consider the New York Police Department's operating budget and their central expenses, which in 2010 were about $10.9 billion, it's less than half, right? So I think that's an important perspective for us to have. So, you know, when President Moon Jae-in and Chairman Kim Jong-un began normalizing relations, which was really the predicate or what allowed for Trump's attempts at normalization, President Moon's approval rating shot up to 80%. And you could see the approval rating sort of go up and down as relations with the North sort of advanced or declined. And there's a multitude of reasons, you know, that Koreans support peace and reunification and that they desire self-determination. You know, the South Korean government doesn't even control its own military forces and the US bases continue to expand there. Last time I was in the South was in fall of 2019 and that was, I went to Pyeongtaek, which is the largest US military base in another country. You know, I mean, they have golf courses there, they have schools. I mean, it's just, it's ridiculous. And it continues to expand. And each time it expands, it displaces, you know, communities there who are largely, you know, farmers and peasants. And so those that remain, you know, their crops, their cattle, everything is threatened by the pollution, by the noise, and by the just the continual expansion of U.S. weaponry and U.S. forces. And, you know, it's never enough. I mean, just recently, U.S. Secretary of Defense Lloyd Austin, he protested the poor living conditions of U.S. soldiers in the South, called it neglectful, called it unacceptable. And this came during the most recent war exercises, you know, which the media really downplays as simulations, but they did actually involve troop movements right up to the 38th parallel. And historically they've entailed nuclear capable submarines and aircraft carriers, the dropping of dummy atomic weapons along the border of North Korea and the decapitation of the leadership. And you know, if you're in North Korea, you don't know if these are exercises or if they're the real thing, right? I mean, I was in the North in 2017 as Trump threatened to rain fire and fury down on the country. And you know, to sort of live with that daily threat is, you know, it's really, you really see who the threat to peace is. And so for some reason though, you know, when the DPRK tests a missile, fires a missile into the ocean, it's seen as a grave threat and a grave provocation. But the real provocation are the war exercises, the US troop presence, and the continued deployment of the terminal high altitude aerial defense system in Korea, which the people there have heroically resisted, continue to resist, blocking roads. And you know, just recently, 2 months ago, US troops mowed down protesters that were blocking a road to one of the bases that was sort of refilling and restocking some of the materials for the missile defense, quote unquote, missile defense system, which obviously is less about the DPRK and much more about China. And the US is really terrified of the normalization of relations between the North and the South, and also the South's so-called strategic ambiguity between the US and China, which are connected, right? I mean, because, you know, one of the main priorities in Korea for rapprochement is to rebuild the railways, right? Which would allow China not only to access, or which would allow the South not only to access the North, but also to trade much more easily with China. And, you know, so it's clear that the people in Korea, in the North and the South, overseas, want peace, independence, and reunification, but this can't happen as long as the old and the new Cold Wars continue. And so we have to fight for the US to sign a peace treaty, to remove all troops from Korea, and to normalize relations with the DPRK on the basis that the DPRK is a nuclear power. So, you know, as we fight for peace, we have to recognize that the DPR's military isn't a threat to peace, but really one of the guarantors of peace in the region. None of us, I think, here want nuclear weapons, but as long as the US has them, you know, it only makes sense for other countries too as well in order to have a real effective deterrent. And in terms of building this movement, we really have to fight against the increasing demonization of China, but also the more deep-seated and long-running demonization and propaganda against North Korea, against its people, its government, and its leadership. Peace with China is intricately connected with peace in Korea. The war has lasted for over 70 years, and it needs to end now before a war with China begins. The Korean people have been fighting for peace that entire time, and it's really time that the entire world peace movement join them, because only a global peace movement of the people and not the actions of individual US leaders is the way to win that peace. Thank you.
A way to win that peace, end the war imposed by the United States on the Korean Peninsula. Very wise words, Derek Ford. Stop the war imposed on the Korean people before the United States escalates its war against the Chinese people. Just to say that the United States has already gone to war against the Chinese people. It's not a question of will there be a war. There is already an imposed war. It's a hybrid war, an information war, a diplomatic war, a war of military pressure, and so on. It's been an interesting panel, a little scary, if I'm to be honest, a little scary, as it should be. The world is a scary place, but before I hand it over to my colleague, I just want to say, don't get scared, friends. Don't get scared. Get organized. We need to change the situation. We at No Cold War are committed to a policy of mutual dialogue, of dialing back from militarism, producing a world of peace, a world of mutual communication, mutual development, and so on. A world, in a sense, that would redeem some of the best aspects of the human experience and try to push against the worst, which is the use of force for a very small number of people to take all the advantages of social labor. It's been a pleasure and a privilege to moderate the first panel. This is the platform of No Cold War. Please go to our website, nocoldwar.org, read our statement, sign our statement, campaign on our statement. Don't get scared, get organized. I'm going to hand it over now to my comrade and colleague, Jenny Clegg. Jenny is the author of China's Global Strategy Towards a Multipolar World, Towards a Multipolar World. I wish, Jenny, please take it away.
Thanks so much, Vijay. And welcome everyone to this second panel of the webinar on peace in the Pacific. We should be discussing US efforts to form an anti-China alliance and no doubt hearing more about activism around the Pacific. Before I bring in the panel, I just want to say a few words of introduction. Biden's foreign policy, we are told, differs from Trump's America First in its multilateral approach. Trump, we should recognize, though, were very successful in one major respect. He brought China in from the margins of US foreign and military policy, right to the center of US concerns. And now it remains for Biden to do so on a global scale, convincing all US allies that China is a problem for the entire world, making the China threat the center focus of international attention. It's not too late to stop China, according to Biden, but the US needs alliances to do so. and he's therefore working to form a new group of defenders of democracy with the Quad, that's the US, Japan, Australia, and India, together with transatlantic allies to develop, if you like, a global NATO. Now, we had the Coalition of the Willing in 2003 to circumvent the UN to go to war in Iraq. Now, Biden's new institutionalized arrangement will surely further sideline the UN as the arbiter of world peace, relegating it to some kind of not too effective development agency. Now, at the risk of sounding completely crazy, let me ask a question. Who owns the Pacific? According to the UN Law of the Sea, nations claim exclusive economic zones extending 200 nautical miles out from their coastlines. And Professor Peter Nolan of Cambridge University in the UK has done some calculations, and he shows that the US claims 9.6 million square kilometers of the Pacific. Believe it or not, France comes second with 6 million square kilometers, and that's because of the French control of the islands such as New Caledonia. Then we find that Britain, where I come from, is also a Pacific power because of the Pitcairn Islands. And so Britain claims around 800,000 square kilometers. And Peter Nolan compares this with China's claim in the South China Sea, or as the Pentagon likes to call it, the West Pacific, of 2 million square kilometers. So that's the US 9.6, France 6, Britain just under 1, and China 2 million square kilometers. Yet it's China that is constantly criticized for the excessive expansionist and even imperialistic claims. On the South China Sea, the narrative goes, Xi Jinping promised Obama in 2015 that he had no intention of militarizing any islands, only then to renege on this promise. This proves the Chinese are not to be trusted. Now, what is left out here is, having gained Xi's assurance, the US promptly sent its naval forces into the area, and this is what caused Xi to change his mind. Now China is seen as trampling over smaller Southeast Asian states with their overlapping claims. In fact, China has peacefully resolved border disputes with most of its neighbors, including an agreement in 2004 to divide the Gulf of Tonkin, with Vietnam getting the larger portion. Now, China might be construed as a bully insofar as it set up a military base within the Philippines' exclusive economic zone. From claiming this one island, China is now seen to threaten the whole of the Indo-Pacific. Only how does China's action differ, for example, from Britain, which has a military garrison on the island of Gibraltar, a stone's throw from the Spanish coast? And where is the international outcry over that? The point that I want to make is that it is by such double standards, distortions, partial truths, that a skewed narrative around the China threat is formed to be used to underpin, to glue together, if you like, a new alliance structure, which then serves as judge, jury, and executioner, deciding what interpretation to put on international law, what intelligence to follow, where the red lines are, and when China transgresses. Then to act as one body to mete out the punishment, be it sanctions, a show of military force, or even a direct intervention. Now, to hear more about Biden's so-called multilateralism and the activities of the US in the Pacific, let's now turn to our panel. We have five speakers with much knowledge and experience behind them. We're on a tight schedule, so without more ado, let me introduce Professor Wang Danming, our first speaker, who is a research fellow at the Charhar Institute in Hong Kong, which is a leading non-government think tank on international relations in China. Her research specialities cover gender and family studies in East Asia, China studies, urban and economic anthropology, and in recent years, she's been involved in numerous projects relating to securing peace and stability in Northeast Asia. So we look forward to hearing from Professor Wang more about the Chinese perspective. Are you there, Professor Wang?
Yes, I'm here. Can you hear me?
Yes, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Jenny, for the introduction. Thanks the board to invite me for this event. I prepare a short talk. A short talk for 8 minutes, and hopefully I will make several points based on my 6 years participation in the Korean Peninsula peace building process with the denuclearization and the unification effort. During the 6 years, it was my honor to be invited in the activities organized by China, Mongolia, South Korea, and the United States of America. Additionally, my comments were also based on my previous work on the Belt Road Project in China. Also, my analysis of Quad and its impact to East Asia. So my research during the past 6 years, 6 to 7 years, has covered these topics. The Biden administration returned to the idea of containing China with more military actions in the Pacific region. But if we check into these moves, there are several internal contradictions which make such aggressive actions hardly work in today's Pacific area. First, the first island chain has been divided into several layers. By layers, I mean the first layer could be seen as expanded into the Quad with Japan, Australia, and India, that the alliance stretched out from Pacific Ocean to the Indian Ocean. The second layer could be seen as the Japan-Taiwan link that has been repeatedly brought up in the most recent Japan and US statement after Blinken visit of Japan. The third layer is the Korean Peninsula, where the US need to work with the South Korean DPRK and China in the near future. Finally, the last layer is the South China Sea. So if you divided these so-called first island chain into these four layers, you can clearly see the contradiction, internal contradiction in this policy design, which doesn't make sense. In each layer that I mentioned above, the mainland China can counter the military force from the US and its allies. But most importantly, different forces of each layer leverage each other, which makes the US further move became impossible. For example, Japan is a major figure in the Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Good.
Yes,
good.
You're back.
Good, I'm glad I'm back. For example, Japan is a major figure in the Quad, but linking Japan with the Taiwan issue equal to linking Japan to China's internal affairs. China has made it extremely clear and firm of its Taiwan policy. The One China policy is the fundamental bottom line for its foreign affairs. If Japan followed the US line by challenging such bottom line, both countries will be in an awkward position in dealing with the Korean Peninsula issue. So for the Korean Peninsula issue, the core countries are the ROK, DPRK, the US, and China. As the region's top security issue, both ROK and the DPRK are working with China and the US. And we can see in this, in the recent ROK and American activities, during which with the purpose of not irritating China. So both countries minimized their reference of China. I participated almost all of the activities in this region regarding the DPRK issue. These policies are contradicting to each other. Japan is excluded from the peninsula issue. In addition to the furious debate on the issue of comfort women during the World War II, ROK remained to be reluctant in dealing with Japan. If Japan intensified its aggressive attitude towards China, no matter as a member of the Quad or on the issue of Taiwan, Japan will be further excluded from the peninsula issue. On the contrary, China remains to be active in the region and is working with all of the neighboring countries in dealing with the peninsula issue. After signing the RCEP and the trade agreement with the EU, the China's Belt Road Initiative remains to be productive. Even though the Belt Road Initiative is an economic development plan, it helps the country to improve its relationship with all of its neighboring countries. In the South China Sea area, both Philippines and Vietnam are actively working with China in this mega plan. And during the COVID-19 pandemic, these countries also work with China for the vaccine and the public health issue. What made the Belt Road Initiative more effective is the fact that there are two lines in the project that connect the Eurasia continent, and the both stretched on land towards the west. It's not an ocean project. It is a land project. If we understand this clearly, we can easily see that adding more military bases in the Pacific area is useless because it's a stretch out on the continent, not through the ocean. So recently, the Korean Moon administration agreed to pay half of the military base expenses. Whether this move could add extra financial burden to the citizens of South Korea and how they are going to react still remain to be, need to be observed. There are also rumors that in the future, the US government would add more military equipment in the South. And in today's news, which is March 23, when I was writing this draft, Great Britain also planned to teach South Korean technologies in developing aircraft carrier. So what does this mean to this area, and what kind of impact it will bring to this area, you need to observe. So that's my presentation. Thank you for having me.
Thank you so much, Professor Wang, for those insights, especially into this new take on the first and second island chains. Of course, this concept was developed during the Korean War, at the beginning of the Cold War, to contain Russia and China. And it's very interesting to see the contradictions that Professor Wang has pointed out. And thanks also for providing the link to our next speaker, who is Kate Hudson, who's my compatriot and co-campaigner, who provides such a steadying hand to the campaign for nuclear disarmament in these times of such uncertainty. Kate has been General Secretary of CND since 2010, having served as chair since 2003. She first became active in the peace movement in the last years of the last Cold War in the big upsurge of activity in both Europe and the Pacific against cruise missiles. She's been a key figure in the anti-war movement nationally and internationally. And so, Kate, if you're there.
I'm here.
Over to you then.
Thanks for your very kind words of introduction, Jenny. And just to apologise for missing the first session, because in fact we did have our CND National Council today. And of course, these are some of the issues that came up for discussion by our elected national leadership. So touching on Jenny's earlier points when she was introducing the session on attempts by Biden to build a multilateral alliance against China, I think this is absolutely the right analysis. And in the past few months, we've seen a global expansion of US policy towards China on a very significant scale. And I'd like to touch just briefly on two of these developments, and that's by NATO and by Britain. At the end of last year, NATO published a new report entitled NATO 2030, United for a New Era. And it very clearly reveals the direction of travel that NATO is taking. The document's chief stated concern is how to maintain Western dominance in a world where China is rising economically. NATO's answer is to expand its orientation to the Asia Pacific to deal with the impact of the emerging China. Ahead of the report's launch, NATO Secretary General Jens Stoltenberg said that China poses, quote, important challenges to our security. And he added that China is coming close to us. The report itself continued the Trumpian approach that NATO should treat China as a, quote, full spectrum systemic rival rather than a purely economic player. The US is already ramping up its military presence in the region. The NATO document also has a strong political message that we've heard before from the US in its description of China and Russia as, quote, revisionist powers seeking to reshape the world on their own authoritarian model. The document says, quote, the scale of Chinese power and global reach poses acute challenges to open and democratic societies, particularly because of that country's trajectory to greater authoritarianism and an expansion of its territorial ambitions. So that's clear, the NATO position. Now, turning to Britain, last month, our government announced a new integrated review security, defence, development and foreign policy. This is an unprecedented scope of coverage in this review. And this review projects and promotes a post-Brexit global Britain, but not a global friendly and constructive Britain, of course, but one that is on the offensive, quotes, projecting force globally. Indeed, it can be summarised as an attack document. It makes much of Britain being Western Europe's most heavily armed nation, of its leadership role in NATO, and its deploying of forces worldwide. Britain is ready to deter, it says, and to defeat if necessary. Its determination to defend democracy against systemic competition, shaping a supposed new open international order, is absolutely a leaf out of the US book, which is now, of course, the NATO book too. And there is much in the document that is reminiscent of the strategies and postures of the former Trump administration. The key strategic shift in the document lies in its focus on the Indo-Pacific region, as it calls it. It's described as a tilt. This includes the Indian Ocean and its two key powers, India and Australia, along with the UK and Japan and others, as a network of regional allies against China. And this, of course, very clearly mirrors the US Quad approach. While the document describes Russia as the most acute threat to Britain, China is clearly the main strategic focus. The review also includes a major announcement on nuclear weapons, with a 40% increase in the UK's nuclear weapons stockpile from around 200 to 260. This reverses three decades of gradual reductions in the UK's nuclear arsenal. And it's at odds with the renewal of the New START treaty, recently by Presidents Biden and Putin, which continues bilateral nuclear weapons reductions between the two countries. And in essence, what it means is that the UK is starting a new nuclear arms race. The review also includes a change in Britain's nuclear use posture. Britain now reserves the right to use nuclear weapons not only against nuclear threats, but against supposedly comparable threats, such as chemical and biological weapons or emerging technologies. This is widely understood to really lower the bar for nuclear weapons use. The previous announcement of the deployment this year of a British and Allied carrier strike group heading to the South China Sea via the Mediterranean and Middle East was reinforced. It will feature the Queen Elizabeth aircraft carrier, and it is described as the UK's most ambitious global deployment for two decades. The review also includes new combat planes, Predator drones, and the expansion of military activities, notably the National Cyber Force with attack capability, the Artificial Intelligence Center, the RAF Space Command, with the first rocket launch due in 2022. So the policies outlined in this review constitute nuclear rearmament, dangerous military expansionism across a vast range of platforms and sectors, and a significant strategic reorientation, joining the US and NATO in hostility towards China. It's a ramping up of aggressive UK posturing that can only contribute to global instability. The peace movement in Britain is working to oppose these developments and to reverse government policies. And some of our forthcoming areas of activity include building civil society opposition to the aircraft carrier strike group going to the South China Sea, building a counter summit to NATO's next projected summit, probably in Brussels in June this year, and also mobilizing opposition to the G7 meeting, which will also have an anti-China orientation and is being held in June in the UK. So there's much to do, and we look forward to working with all organizations possible to secure our aims of a peaceful world. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Kate. Indeed, we've got our hands very full. Thank you for filling in on how Europe in NATO, as well as Britain, are tilting towards the Indo-Pacific. I'll just mention that one of our activists in CND at the meeting just now said that perhaps we shouldn't be talking about a Cold War anymore because the threat of war, the situation is so dangerous. And of course, the use of nuclear weapons, possibly against a cyber attack, is a warning to China not to use a cyber attack against Taiwan. So I'll now move on to our next speaker, who is Lisa Natividad. She's an assistant professor with the Division of Social Work at the University of Guam. She's also president of the Guahan Coalition for Peace and Justice, and she has delivered interventions to the United Nations on issues of militarization, colonization, and indigenous peoples' rights. So, of course, Guam is a US territory. It's part of the what was known as the Second Island Chain. I'm sure she will tell us more about Guam and its involvement in US strategy. So, Lisa, if you're there.
I am here. Thank you. Do you see my screen share?
Absolutely, yes.
Okay, great. Thank you, Jenny, for that introduction. And I wanted to begin by addressing your question of who owns the Pacific. And as a native person from the island of Guam, or Guam as it's more popularly known to the world, we as indigenous peoples clearly have rights to the lands, territory, and resources, as is outlined in the United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. And so I wanted to start by sharing this map here of our region. And as you can see, my island here of Guam is the, sort of the central connecting point in terms of the strategic geopolitical dynamics in the Asia Pacific region. And so our island has been noted to be the center stage of many different military triangles with the United States, spanning and connecting the East with the West, particularly looking at connections to Alaska and San Diego, clearly part of the Pacific Command in Hawaii, as well as into the various bases in Korea's, with the Korea, South Korea, as well as throughout Japan and all the way down to Australia. And so as you can see from this slide, clearly our positionality in the Pacific makes us, it proves to be very problematic in terms of the exploitation and use of our lands. So our island is an unincorporated territory of the United States. We've been so since the end of the Spanish-American War in 1898. And we remain on the United Nations list of non-self-governing territories and have been, we're one of the remaining 17 remnants globally of the colonial period. And so we've been on the list since its inception. And you can see how negotiating our freedom and any kind of political development is very much very difficult with its challenges, because the US, of course, with us as a territory, has what it refers to as quote unquote maximum flexibility, meaning essentially that they can do whatever they wish without any consultation, not even with our elected leadership. And so our island is very, very tiny in the Pacific. We're about 212 square miles. My apologies if you're a metric system person. And our population base is just over 170,000 people. But what is notable on such a small, tiny place is the fact that the DOD's footprint, Department of Defense, US Department of Defense, footprint on our island is roughly one third, or between 29 and 31% of the island. And so the Department of Defense actually is the largest single landowner of the island. And in contrast, our local government of Guam only controls 19% of our land. And so this has been the case since primarily since the end of World War II. There, with the recent announcement, and this is where we connect to the movement in Okinawa, in 2006, there was an announcement that they would be transferring roughly 8,000 Marines from Okinawa to Guam, which of course would have resulted in an increase and is already an active plan that's in place in terms of the increased militarization of the island. And had their plans come to fruition as anticipated, they would control up to 42% of our island. And so what has militarization meant for us in the Pacific? And so it's meant a number of different things. And in this slide, I wanted primarily to convey an environment that is highly hyper-militarized. You know, when we talk about the Cold War and we talk about the thawing of the Cold War, the possible, you know, engaging the Cold War in so many ways, war has never thawed for us in the Pacific, particularly in my island. We, as you can see in these images here, our region, and when I say our region, I'm specifically referring to Micronesia, which is the region within the Pacific that Guam is located. We've been complicit to, as is in this photo here, human radiation experiments, particularly with the nuclear testing that has happened in the Marshall Islands. We have hyper-militarization of our youth, largely being, as a territory, one of the highest areas of enlistment in U.S. Department of Defense, largely due to economic constraints of the development of our economy and consequentially the elevation of U.S. military enlistment as part of the economic conscripts in a territory. You also see, ironically enough, hyper-American allegiance. And you see this because of the fact that in this case, we were an active war zone. And so hence you see invasion as well as the remnants of war that continue today. And so when we look at the legacy of what it's meant, the US's footprint in Micronesia on Guam, you see land dispossession, obviously taken for the purposes of base development. We see the radiation exposure that stems from the islands. And what's not often spoken of is those who are within downwind of detonation sites. And in the case of our island, we are within direct downwind of the Marshall Islands. And so our level of exposure to radiation, we have data that suggests that it is close to rivaling the numbers in the Marshall Islands in terms of strontium 90 levels and other radioactive isotopes. Clearly, when you have bases, you have high levels of environmental devastation, toxic contamination, not only from military training exercises and war preparation, but also from active war zones, right? And so we see this as very problematic, particularly when you look at current health outcomes of our people. There's the desecration of ancestral remains for the development of bases. This is just today, as a matter of fact, we had a protest looking at the development of lands for the purposes of this new military buildup and its impact that it's had in terms of disturbing ancestral remains in the, from their natural placement. We have poor health outcomes, particularly looking at cancer rates. We have high rates of death from war because of the high rates of enlistment. And of course, the experience of war occupation, particularly in World War II, we had sex slavery with comfort women, although we're not known for this. This certainly occurred on our island during the World War II period, work encampments, torture, and massacres during this time frame. In addition, there's the prohibition of traditional practices, such as access to fishing grounds, which is a traditional practice, as well as access to medicines that are used in our traditional systems to heal our bodies. As part of this presence as well is our complicity to war and destruction. So Guam is most known for our involvement, if you will, in terms of World War II, but even more recently in terms of the DPRK threats to the island. And of course, we as native peoples of the island have absolutely nothing to do with why we're being threatened. However, the US's presence clearly compromises our safety. And so part of what ends up happening is our complicity to war. So within our region as well, in the Mariana Island chain, we have the island of Tinian to the north of our island, which is the place from which the bombs that were sent to Hiroshima and to Nagasaki were detonated or were sent. And so this complicity to war and destruction is something that obviously we're not comfortable with and that needs to be, we're pretty much held at the discretion of the United States. And so for us on the ground, you know, we vision peace and we really, this little girl here, her name is Gwenaiza, her name in our language means love and really is, we're very motivated by considering future generations and reclaiming the Pacific for ourselves. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Lisa, for filling in our understanding of the militarization in the Pacific and indeed the strategic importance of Guam, and also for showing how antithetical the US project is to people's interests and people's rights. So thank you very much for that. And we'll now move on to the next speaker, who is Kawena Kapahwa, who is an organizer and activist in the Hawaiian independence movement, as well as labor movements and campaigns to protect and preserve Hawaiian culture. He's co-organizer of the Cancel RIMPAC Coalition, and I'm sure he'll tell us more about RIMPAC. So over to you, Kawena.
Mahalo again for having me on this panel. Before I get to my major talking points, I'd like to address the fact that despite this panel being about trying to avoid a new Cold War or the brewing Cold War with China via the US, I'd like to mention the fact that US militarism in the Pacific has an ongoing death toll, which especially impacts the Micronesian community, which tragically rose this week with the police murder of a 16-year-old Chukchi's child named I Remember Saikap. His community and homeland have been devastated by U.S. militarism, and his murder is a culmination of the impacts of U.S. military activity in his homeland and the continued enforced poverty against his community by the U.S. military. Some background history. Hawaii was illegally invaded by the U.S. military in 1893 to overthrow our sovereign government, our native sovereign government, and ever since we've been under illegal occupation by the United States. The United States struggled to annex Hawaii at first due to the internalized and white supremacist ideology that was rooted in the United States. And during this, the United States, particularly the McKinley administration, was able to overcome this resistance to the annexation of Hawaii due to it being a majority non-white population by expressing the goal of using Hawaii as an imperialist outpost to get, quote, get their share of China. So it's very clear ever since the inception of the U.S. Occupation of Hawaii that their goal is to not only take Hawaii to use as an imperial outpost, but to use it as a projection of their power to reach China. And so we understand that China has always been their end goal. With the as far as the situation in Hawaii goes, the U.S. military currently occupies about one-fifth of all land in Hawaii, similar to what it does in Guam. And 56% of this land is deemed unceded lands, or lands that are stolen directly from the Hawaiian people that had been demarcated by the Hawaiian Kingdom government as for the benefit of the Hawaiian people, and are now used instead to oppress the Hawaiian people as well as our Pacific Islander cousins. And this is very well expressed by the fact that for very many years, the U.S. Occupied the island of Ko'olawe, an entire island in the Hawaiian archipelago, and used it as a bombing target, which was very heavily used during the RIMPAC exercises that were mentioned earlier by Anne Wright. The RIMPAC exercises are, like Anne said, one of the largest military exercises in the world, and they take place on Native Hawaiian land. And the cost of these exercises is immense. Not only are they completely environmentally destructive to our land, they also destroy multiple cultural sites regularly. But one of the major uses of RIMPAC is to build this anti-China alliance. And this is done by bringing in American allied countries in the Pacific to train in Hawaii. In certain instances, in certain RIMPAC exercises, they have, if you look at the types of training they've practiced, some have included the express invasion of Pacific Island countries of fictional and created Pacific Island countries, and then the occupation and suppression of Native insurgency in these communities. And so this is a clear exposing of American ideology and agenda in the Pacific. This also includes the fact that the U.S. uses the RIMPAC exercises to train nation militaries such as Indonesia, which is currently committing genocide in West Papua. And so we need to understand that Hawaii, in terms of its use by the U.S. military, is not only as an imperial outpost to project power, but also as a training facility to train its fellow capitalist imperialist countries to help it in its future conflict with China. U.S. military propaganda continues to tell everyone that if the U.S. military is not present in the Pacific, that Pacific islands such as Guam and Hawaii will be exploited by other countries. And we are very certain that this is obviously not true, given the U.S. is the one oppressing us at the moment. But also, this was shown to be a falsehood in 2018. For those of you who don't know, at the time, Trump was saber rattling with North Korea. And at the time, because of this saber rattling, we had a unfortunate false nuclear missile alert that happened in Hawaii in January. And obviously this rattled many people because of the ongoing political tensions globally. Of course, thankfully this turned out to be false, but it exposed the fact that the US military is not only incapable of protecting Hawaii or any other Pacific island, it is not trying to. And so when this happened, it should expose that the U.S. does not actually care for the people it occupies. It only is using our Pacific Islands and our people as human shields for U.S. citizens in the continental U.S. That's why currently the Hawaiian independence movement views Hawaii as a fulcrum for American imperialism in the Pacific. And this is supported by the Pohakuloa training area, which is on the Big Island of Hawaii, or Hawaii Island. It's the largest American land-based training facility in the Pacific, and it's critical to their U.S. Indo-Pacific strategy. They do live fire trainings there. They've utilized depleted uranium munitions there as well. Pohakulo is an extremely important and critical sacred site for the Hawaiian people. And so via the U.S. occupation of this land, not only are they preparing their troops to enact violence against other indigenous sovereign communities, but also continuing their oppression and violence against the Hawaiian community by destroying more and more of our cultural sites. Pohakuloa is an area of 442 square kilometers. So it's as big as some of the islands in our archipelago. And it's situated directly over one of the largest aquifers on Hawaii Island, which obviously water is a life-giving source. And if we don't have it, it's very difficult to live on these islands. And so this directly threatens our ability to just live on our islands. And Pohakuloa is one of the main training facilities the U.S. uses to train its fellow military allies in the RIMPAC exercises. Indonesia has regularly used these, as well as New Zealand and Australia, Japan as well, and they regularly bomb them. In 2019, when Hawaiians took to Mauna Kea, which is the largest mountain in Hawaii, to protect sacred Hawaiian land against a development taking place at the summit, the U.S. military continued bombing while we were just a few miles down the road or a few kilometers down the road, so much so that we were able to not only see the bombing, but hear it and feel it as the ground shook. And so we continue to see this buildup of the US military in Hawaii. Currently, one of the project proposals that's going forward is attempting to build a new missile defense base on the island of Kauai. It was originally slated for the island of Oahu, which is the most heavily militarized. The US currently controls about 26% of land on Oahu, so about one-fifth-ish. And so they decided that basically there was a lot of opposition to this project and they were going to move it to the more rural island of Kauai. Once again, this shows that Hawaii is nothing more than a human shield for the U.S. to protect itself. And it has no interest in protecting us. It's solely using us as a forward operating facility to protect its U.S. continental-based citizens. And so we understand through history that Hawaii's express purpose for the U.S. occupation was to reach China, and now it's being used to contain China, according to the U.S. military, as they begin to build out this new strategy of using Pacific Islands as a sort of barrier between them and between the U.S. and China. As they're attempting to create this island chain of missile defense to contain China, they will be continuing to put us and other indigenous peoples in danger. Obviously, this puts the Hawaiian people as a target for military action, but also our Micronesian cousins, our cousins in other Polynesian islands, as well as those in Australia or anywhere else in the Pacific. And so in order to counter this, it's the express opinion of the Hawaiian independence movement that we need to be seeking sovereignty and independence for Pacific Islands, because as Lisa mentioned earlier, in terms of who owns the Pacific, it should be the indigenous people of the Pacific who have the rights to their own land, the rights to their waters, to live and express their cultures as they see fit, and not be dominated by the U.S. imperialists at this time. When we look at how the U.S. Propaganda has permeated over the years, we see multiple similarities in terms of how Hawaii has fared with Guam when compared. Hawaiians also make up a huge portion of or have a large percentage of military enrollment, which, you know, is very based upon survivalism because of the poverty in our communities. Many people see it as the only way out of poverty. And so many people enroll in the military, which actively is using them to oppress their fellow Hawaiians as well as destroy their own land. And this cycle is incredibly harmful to our people. The Hawaiian independence movement has been strengthening since the 1970s, since the last Cold War, truly, and moving toward a removal of the U.S. from the Pacific region, not only for ourselves, but for all Pacific Islands. And if we are to see the thriving of the Pacific Island community, where we know that the U.S. must not be in the Pacific anymore, given that it will only use us as military weapons and military facilities. And so a free Hawaii is critical to a peaceful Pacific for everyone, because it will deny the U.S. an imperialist outpost in the Pacific through which it can use the infrastructure it's established here to continue to oppress our brothers and sisters in Guam, in Micronesia, in French Polynesia, and other, or in other Polynesian countries, or even in Asia. And we saw this when the U.S. used Hawaii as its base of operations for Korea, when it used Hawaii as a base of operations for Vietnam and other Asian intervention programs. And we know this especially because the U.S. continues to use Hawaii, specifically the island of Oahu, as the central hub and command center of Indo-Pacific Command, which is, as mentioned earlier, the new project of the United States military. And so in order for us to achieve a peaceful Pacific for everyone, the Hawaiian independence movement is working toward working to build solidarity with other indigenous groups, because if the sovereignty of indigenous groups is achieved, then we understand that the US military will be negated from using us as human shields and weapons of war. And so if we want to build a peaceful Pacific together, a free Hawaii is necessary, a free Guam is necessary, as well as any other Pacific island that wishes to be free to help repel American aggression in the Pacific. Mahalo.
Thank you very much, Koena, for that. Very tragic to hear of your announcement of that young man at the beginning. RIMPAC is obviously extremely important for us campaigners, and we need to keep an eye on who is participating in that. And thank you so much for presenting the case for Hawaiian independence. I'll now move on to our last speaker, who is Rob Kajiwara. He's a writer, musician, and activist of Okinawan descent. He's president of Peace for Okinawa Coalition and has played a key role in the campaign to stop the construction of US Marine of the US Marine base in Okinawa. In 2019, he spoke at the United Nations 41st Human Rights Council demanding an investigation into Japan's human rights violations against the Ryukyuans. Sorry, I haven't said that very well. So I'm sure that Rob is going to fill us in on the US Marine base and his activities in Okinawa. Thank you. If Rob's there.
I'm Robert Fija Kajiwara. Thank you to Carlos Martinez and No Cold War for inviting me to speak today. Thank you also to all of the other presenters and to everyone watching. I am native Luchuan, also known as Okinawan or Uchinanju. I'm also native Hawaiian. Before we continue, I should mention that this video contains images of graphic violence and warfare. Viewer discretion is advised. I am president of Uchina Wada Nushinka, or Peace for Okinawa Coalition, headquartered in Uchinashi, or Okinawa City. We are a nonprofit organization founded and led by millennial Luchuans, or Uchinanchu, in order to promote Luchu culture, history, languages, and issues. We work closely with many other groups in Luchu, particularly the Luchu Independence Action Network, founded by Mr. Shigenori Yamahara. We also work with many other groups abroad, particularly with Native Hawaiians and other indigenous peoples. Luchuans are the indigenous peoples of the Luchu Islands, as recognized by UNESCO, CERD, the UN Human Rights Committee, and many other organizations and scholars. According to archaeologists, Luchuans have inhabited the Luchu Islands for over 32,000 years. We have our own unique history, culture, languages, and identity. Historically, Luchu had very close, friendly, and mutually beneficial relationships with China, Korea, and Southeast Asia. Luchu was a center of international trade, finance, diplomacy, and cross-cultural exchange, and Luchu has never declared war on another nation. In the year 1609, the Satsuma clan of Japan, which was Japan's largest and most warlike clan, attacked Luchu, forcing Luchuans to pay tribute. However, Luchu maintained its sovereignty and continued to thrive as an independent country. During the mid-19th century, Luchu became internationally recognized by the Western nations as an independent country with the signing of treaties with the United States, France, and the Netherlands. In 1879, Japan used its new Western-style military to illegally annex Luchu against the will of Luchuans. Luchuans appealed to their friend China for help, but China at the time was too weak. During World War II, Japan intentionally placed an inordinate amount of military presence onto Uchina or Okinawa Island with the deliberate intent of sacrificing Uchinanchu or Okinawans in order to protect Japan. This resulted in the Battle of Okinawa in 1945, in which more than one-fourth of the Uchinanchu population was killed during a time span of just 3 months. Japanese soldiers intentionally murdered thousands of Uchinanchu, including women, children, and the elderly, and also forced thousands of others to commit suicide. After the war, most of Japan's other colonies received back their independence, except for Luchu, because the United States military decided to keep Luchu for itself to use for military bases. Luchuans lived under direct U.S. military rule, had no form of democracy, and strongly opposed the U.S. military. Professor Hoshin Nakamura of Okinawa University survived the Battle of Okinawa, but lost his younger brother. He has been an advocate for the restoration of Luchu's independence for over 50 years. He and other Luchuans at the time demanded a restoration of Luchu's independence, but the U.S. ignored these demands and in 1972 gave Luchu to Japan without a vote from Luchuans, which is illegal under international law. And since then, Luchuans have lived under joint U.S. and Japanese occupation. Professor Nakamura told me that during the Vietnam War, the U.S. military said that they are in Okinawa in order to protect Okinawans from the Viet Cong. However, the Viet Cong won the war and never invaded Okinawa. Now the U.S. military is saying the exact same thing about China. However, due to the long history of peace and friendship between China and Luchu, the overwhelming majority of Luchuans do not see China as a threat. Even the U.S. government has privately admitted this via WikiLeaks. Luchu shares a ocean border with China. So if the overwhelming majority of Luchuans don't see China as a threat, the U.S. and other nations should also be asking, is China truly a military threat? The truth is around 80 to 90% of Luchuans or Uchinanchu oppose the U.S. military presence of our islands. Although Uchina or Okinawa makes up less than 1% of Japan's land area, it contains over 70% of the military presence, including 30,000 U.S. soldiers, along with their families, as well as American civilian workers, making for a total of around 80,000 Americans. These Americans often commit crime in Uchina, including violent crime against women and children. Also, U.S. military aircraft often have accidents in Uchina, endangering the lives of both Uchinanchu civilians as well as the soldiers themselves. The military also causes numerous environmental problems, including the poisoning of Uchina's drinking water with cancer-causing agents. The military takes up over 15% of Uchina's land and around 30% of the arable land, yet contributes only around 5% to the economy, running at a huge economic burden on the Uchinanchu people. Given all of these problems, we hope you can see why we strongly dislike the military occupation of our islands. We are working to restore Luchu's rightful independence, remove the military from our islands, and once again make Luchu a center for peace and prosperity. I'm just about out of time for today, so I'll end here. Thank you again to everyone for watching. If you would like more information, please check out our website, apeaceforokinawa.org. Thank you again, and I'll see you next time.
I'm sorry, I just have to add that I am not of Okinawan descent. I am Uchinanchu or Okinawan. I did not use that term to describe myself. I am Okinawan. I'm not of descent. Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much, Rob. And again, highlighting the indigenous people of the Pacific. Surely the indigenous people in this area must be the most overlooked and forgotten about peoples in the world, and whose rights have been negated and wiped out. But I think we can see from our contributions what an inspiration these people of the islands are in terms of their activism for peace. They've had the experience, long historical experience of the militarization of the Pacific over decades. And now they are continuing to stand up for a peaceful Pacific against the very dangerous developments in the new Cold War and the American aggression and alliance building. So I think that this has been a tremendously informative session that's brought the peaceful Pacific and the problems of militarization of the Pacific, which are now at the center of world attention. So it just remains for me to thank our contributions to this panel, and in particular, thank you from me for keeping to time. We have overrun quite a bit, but I think it's been worthwhile. This has been a no Cold War event, and I urge you to keep in touch with No Cold War if you haven't already done so, to sign the statement, to keep checking out the No Cold War website for future events. And with that, I will bring the session to a close. So thank you once again from No Cold War. Thank you.